أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful, all praise is due to Allah. And may His peace and blessings be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace, the blessings and the mercy of Allah be upon all of you. And welcome back again to Faith in Action. And for the past few weeks, we have been discussing the concept of faith as it is demonstrated and manifested in this whole notion of our relationships with others. Relationships, generally speaking, and we began talking about our relationship with ourselves and what are the principles, what are the values that we need to hold, what are the steps that we need to take in order to have a good relationship with ourselves. Keeping in mind that our relationship with other people is nothing but a reflection of our relationship with ourselves. And that is why we started this series on relationships by beginning with our relationship with ourselves. And before that, we started by talking about our attitude towards man. Remember we said the six or the five principles that Islam has set regarding man, that man is honorable and is a noble creature. Man is created by the hands of God. Man is created by the hands of God in the best form. Man is being bestowed and given intellectual abilities. That God has facilitated for man that which is on earth and that which is up in heaven. And that God actually promises man to go to paradise. So every human being that we meet is a person who potentially can be of the dwellers of paradise. And we said that if we were to bring and recall all these elements as we are dealing with those who are around us, we will see less oppression, we will see less violence, we will see less dehumanization, and we will see less devaluing of each other. So Islam gives this big framework into how to relate to other people in principle. But then also, Islam is very specific as far as how we view human beings. And then it gives details and examples of other types of relationships. So in a beautiful summary fashion, it is stated in Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. Allah said, beginning the command, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah and do not associate any with Him. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And also the command now is to be dutiful or to be good to your parents. وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى. And that you take care of your relatives. And then it says, وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. And the orphans and the needy. And the neighbors, be they strangers or be they related, and taking care also of companions on the side. Now that is just part of these types of relationships that we have somehow to be part in. Either all of it or some of it. We human beings, we are social beings. We cannot operate on our own. We must belong to a system. That system is either one of family, and sometimes, unfortunately, some people do not have any family member. Maybe there was a catastrophe and they outlived every single family member that they had. Like, unfortunately, what has happened in the tsunami, for example. Or, if that is not there, then we certainly have neighbors. Because, again, we have to live somewhere. And wherever it is that we are living, there are going to be people around us. Maybe the case is that we don't have people around us. Then Allah said, how about people who are our companions, maybe friends? Maybe we don't have friends. And that is where some of the scholars said that when Allah says that people who are on the side, companions who are on the side, is in reference either to people that we work with, people that we go to school with, somehow we have a relationship with another human being. In what capacity? That is determined by the type of the relationship that we have with them. So for example, Allah speaks about the people who are going to be closest to us. And what I love about this command is, and this happens actually throughout the Quran, وَعَبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah and do not associate any with Him. In more than one place in the Quran, after this command, always comes a command that speaks about being dutiful to your parents. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. In Surah Al-Isra, Allah says, and your Lord has prescribed that you worship none but Him and that you be dutiful to your parents. The scholars point out to the association. It said that Allah says, worship Allah, do not associate others with Him. And then He says, and be good to your parents. And the scholars point out to this association and they say, that is really beautiful and that is very remarkable. Now, the way that we worship Allah is definitely not the way that we would, you know, be considering our parents. But it said that to point out the importance of caring of the parents, Allah said, you worship me. And what comes next in importance is that you be dutiful to your parents. And that is beautiful. That is one relationship. They say also part of this association is that worship Allah, do not associate others with Him, and be dutiful to your parents, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who facilitates, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who supplies with all these blessings. But the one who takes the blessings of Allah and immediately facilitates it for us are our parents. So Allah is the provider and the facilitator, and the parents happen to be the agents of that providing and that facilitation. And that is also really a beautiful remark out there. So here Allah is telling us to worship none but Him and then to be dutiful to the parents. So what we have here is, in Surah Al-Isra, it told us part of that appreciation, part of that ihsan, is that you pray for them, for example. That is just part, one part of it, or one aspect of it. And that's why in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after all these reminders of the Quran, of the idea of being dutiful to your parents, now comes a warning of disobeying your parents. In the hadith, or not disobeying, because unfortunately sometimes we may have to disobey our parents depending on what it is that we are being commanded by them. But the Prophet ﷺ talks about situations where a person is just being negligent, a person is just being totally ungrateful, and describes this as uquq. The Prophet ﷺ is so disappointed by a person like that, to the point that he said, a person who is ungrateful to his parents, let them do any act of goodness that they want to do, Allah will not consider their deeds. Because what it is that they're guilty of is so severe that it prevents other goodness to be considered that they have done. So this is a relationship that is based on recognition and acknowledgement of, subhanAllah, had it not been for them, had it not been for the unconditional love, unconditional care, unconditional sympathy, and absolutely the desire of wanting just good for me, what parents do, what parents feel, nobody else can claim that, subhanAllah. So Allah said, well, how do you meet this? And that is also part of the mercy of Allah, that Allah created us in this family where we find, you know, the shoulders to cry on, the love that we receive, subhanAllah. That is beautiful. So it's a relationship that is based on appreciation or acknowledgement and recognition of the goodness that has been extended to us by our parents. So Allah said, well, how do you meet this? He said, you meet it by ihsan. And sometimes the Quran intentionally uses these broad words so that, because you do not want to define it, you do not want to be technical about these types of relationship. You want to leave it as broad as possible so that any act of goodness actually qualifies to be an act that is to be extended to the parents. But it all begins with this idea of appreciation and being a person of shukr and being a person of gratitude, indebtedness to the goodness that you recognize that has been extended to you by your parents. So a person of faith is a person that respects the parents. A person of faith is a person that honors the parents. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about this idea of, Prophet of Allah, how much have I really done to my parents? He would see a person carrying his parent on their back and going around, you know, performing hajj with them. It moves him, but then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, you really haven't done much compared to what your parents have done to you. This young man comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanting to go to the battlefield, committing himself to jihad. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam immediately asks, how are your parents? Tell me about your parents. Are they both or either one of them alive? And the man said, yes, Messenger of Allah, that is the case. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, go there and commit yourself to their service, for that is going to be your jihad. Honor your parents by that. We have the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he tells the young man, ilzam qadamayha, be by her feet, for that is where paradise is, under the mother's feet. Indeed, an important topic, and inshallah we will come back to it after our break, so please stay tuned and we will be back inshallah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful, all praise is due to him and may his peace and blessings be upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the blessings and the mercy of Allah be upon all of you. And welcome back again to Faith in Action, where our discussion for this part of our program is on the concept of family. And specifically, we're talking about relationships, and today the focus is on family relationships. It was beautifully once said that a happy family is an early heaven, and that is really nice. What they're saying is that a happy family that is genuinely caring for each other, where all members of it are respected, say that a family that is happy, say that almost it's an early heaven. And most likely the person who made that statement is fully aware of what it means to be or to belong to a miserable family. So the Quran speaks about this concept of family, but the way that it does, because families are ultimately parents on one side and then siblings and children on the other side. So the Quran speaks about this concept, and it begins by asking people to care for the very foundation and founders for that family. And these are the walidain, the parents. Take care of the parents. And as we have said in numerous places in the Quran, Allah equates, لَا تَعَبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ. Do not worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And take care of the parents, or extend any act of goodness to the parents. وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah and do not associate any with him. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And take care of your parents. This is the building block. And what happens is that since they are really the foundation of this family, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by asking us to honor our parents. That is where it all begins at, by the people who founded this family. So in the Quran, Allah speaks about the rights of the parents, as well as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we said that it is part of gratitude, acknowledgement, appreciation of what goodness our parents have extended to us. Now that when we are of an age where we are capable of doing so, the least that is required of us is honoring and respecting. You cannot question the authority of the parents. You cannot belittle the work and the sacrifice that they have done. You cannot be ungrateful for what they have extended to us as we were young. And subhanallah, so beautiful sometimes to see how much, especially for mothers, how much a mother is willing to sacrifice and give for her child. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam absolutely just loved this. After one of the battles, the Prophet, peace be upon him, came back. And there was this woman, she was just frantically looking into children. If this is her child or not, she would run when she sees a child and she would turn him around to see if this is her child or not. And the Prophet ﷺ is so moved by this that he is following her wherever she is going to see what is the end of it. And finally, she found her baby, and this woman hugged that child so tight to her, and she started feeding him. And the Prophet ﷺ is asking the companions, see that woman, see that woman? And at the end of it, they all looked. And he said, a woman who behaved in such a way. He said, do you expect that woman to throw her son or her baby in the fire? And they said, Prophet of Allah, after what we have seen, there is no way that this woman would throw her baby in the fire. There is just that's not possible. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah is more merciful than that mother towards her baby. That is beautiful. But the point is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was moved by this, and how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept following this woman, and he's making reaction, acknowledging how this woman feels, and acknowledging also how this woman in the future feels about the baby, that this is not a type of a person that would throw in her baby in the fire. What is the point? The point is, as a person of faith, you cannot, and that is absolutely not acceptable, that we do not pay attention to our familial responsibilities. And that familial responsibility begins with the way that we behave towards our parents, the way that we talk to them, the way that we display respect to them, the way that we honor them, the way that we obey them. Even, subhanAllah, the voice that we use when we are talking to them. You know, in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells a story of these three people, three individuals that went to sleep in a cave. And when they woke up, they found out that a big rock has come and closed the cave on them. And they knew that they had absolutely no way out without divine intervention. And they said that there was just absolutely no way out for us without Allah helping us in this. So they said, well, how do we go about begging Allah? So they all said, let us beg Allah by the best deeds that each and every one of us has performed. You say, oh Allah, I performed this deed and it was really done for your sake. Oh Allah, Allah, please save us out of this. And that is why the scholars say that it is possible to seek intercession by means of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the good deeds that we have done. So this person said, you know, one time I had this beautiful cousin of mine and I really desired her and she had some difficult times and I offered to help her if she would sleep with me. And once I invited her and I had full access to that, she was crying, or what has happened is that I said, what is going on? She said, I've never done this before and I've never disobeyed Allah in such a fashion. He said, I gave that up and I gave it up for the sake of Allah. Oh Allah, I did this for your sake. What happened is that the rock moved a little bit, but not big enough for them to walk out from. And so the other person tells his story. And then one of them said, he had parents. And now he's begging Allah through the good deed that he has done. Said that I used to feed my parents before I fed my children. And one day said that they asked for milk and the children asked for milk. The children were crying. So I said, I put my children to sleep. And then I came to the room to feed my parents, but they were sleeping. He said, I was so concerned that I did not want them to wake up in the middle of the night wanting the milk and me not being there. And I did not want to wake them up because I did not want to disturb them. So he said, I held that bowl of milk in my hand. He said, I was just waiting for them to wake up and I did this for the sake of Allah. He said that at that point, the rock was moved and they all were able to get out of the cave. Now again here, the beautiful part of the story is, here is a person who is talking about his level of dedication, his level of love and care for the parents that he has had. And that is beautiful, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated this, about this person, that there was a divine intervention, that the rock was actually moved out of the way so that these people can walk out of that cave and be saved. And it was all done partially because of how good a person has been to his parents. Now, our families are our lines of defense. This is where we come in to find safety and security. And this is where we become. This is really where we are molded. This is where we are formulated, and this is where we are brought up. And we're constantly praying and saying, رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِ صَغِيرًا. Oh Allah, shower them with your mercy as they have reared me up when I was young. You know, be you the daughter or the son. So at any case, Allah speaks about these relationships, familial relationships, where people have duties and they also have obligations. And what has happened in our families most of the time is that we ask for our rights without really being of those who are paying our duties or fulfilling our obligations. And that is why they say that truly the definition of justice is that we give others everything that we ask for ourselves. So in a familial relationship, is that the type of attitude that we bring in or not? And that is, as a member of this family, be I the father, the mother, be I the son or the daughter, or the brother and the sister, what are my obligations and what can I expect in return, realistically speaking, that is. So it says that as parents, we have a duty. Now, subhanAllah, the way that we treat our children is going to determine how they treat us when we grow older. So it will be implausible that we expect, you know, respect from our children if we did not display enough compassion and kindness and love to them as they were young. Once we do that, we can expect, and most likely, inshallah, we will receive this in return as well, where we take care of our parents. But then again, the point remains, and that is a person of faith is a person who is always appreciative. And that is why in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ explains this idea of how faith shapes your attitude regarding our relationship with other people. Here he is sitting with Aisha, and then he hears a voice of this woman. She's coming in to visit. And the Prophet ﷺ invites her in. And when he invites her in, he gets out of his place and he has her sit down there and he's asking her, how are your parents and how's your family? How is this and how's that? A lot of care and concern about this woman. When she leaves, Aisha asks, Prophet of Allah, who's this woman? That you've been so honoring and hospitable towards her, who is this woman? And the Prophet ﷺ explains and he said, well, this is one of the friends of Khadija. She used to visit us during the time of Khadija. And then he makes a beautiful statement and he says, وَإِنَّ حُسْنَ الْعَهْدِ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. And he said that, and to be dutiful to relationships is part of faith. حُسْنَ الْعَهْدِ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. To care for these relationships is part of faith. And that is beautiful. So our family is the first agent of socialization that we belong to. It is our line of defense. It is where we have received compassion, where people were good to us. And as people of faith, we have to meet this with absolute gratitude and appreciation, translated in action into respect, into honoring, into acknowledgement, into recognition, into prayers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our parents, forgive our parents, and if they have passed away, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make their abode paradise, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And with this, we come to the conclusion of this part of our program. And as always, thank you for joining us. Until we meet next time, inshallah, we say so long. And assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.